Arthur and Molly Weasley are two of the most loving and caring wizards we encounter in the wizarding world. The two would meet when they were very young and fall in love. In time, they would raise seven strong and talented children with hearts as big as their own. Today, we're going to dive into their stories from where they began to where they ended up. This is the life of Arthur and Molly Weasley. Arthur was born on February 6, 1950, to Septimus and Cedrella Weasley. He was one of three sons to the loving couple. The Weasleys were once considered part of the Pure Blood Sacred 28. Some of the other Pure Blood families, however, would later consider the Weasleys as blood traitors for their views on muggles. Arthur would go on to attend Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry in the 1960s. He would be sorted into the Gryffindor house. The Gryffindor traits of chivalry and courage were seen in Arthur throughout his life. While at school, Arthur would meet a fellow student for whom he would fall head over heels for. This, of course, was Molly Prewett, his future wife. Molly was born on October 30th, 1949, to Mr. and Mrs. Prewett. She had two brothers, Fabian and Gideon. The Prewett family were also considered part of the Pure Blood Sacred 28. Molly also attended Hogwarts, and like Arthur, she was sorted into the Gryffindor house. This is likely how the pair met. Molly was well-suited for Gryffindor, as she could check the box for all the traits typical of Gryffindors. Arthur and Molly had an undeniable connection, even back at school. They would sneak out of their dormitories at night to spend time together. They even once got caught for it one late evening. Arthur was captured and punished by the caretaker Pringle. However, Molly managed to slip away. She made it back to the Gryffindor Tower at 4 in the morning, only to get yelled at by the fat lady portrait. Shortly after graduating from Hogwarts, the pair got married. Some thought it was rather rushed, and it was becoming more common to see younger wizards getting married due to the potential wizarding war on the rise. In truth, the two of them were deeply in love, and that's why they got married. Arthur started working at the Ministry of Magic in the Misuse of Muggle Artifacts office. He would regulate the use of magic on Muggle objects and keep such items away from Muggle hands. The job included doing raids to collect bewitched dark magic items. Arthur was fascinated with Muggle items, so this job seemed perfect. They quickly started a family and would go on to have seven children. On November 29, 1970, Molly gave birth to their first son, William, otherwise known as Bill, Weasley. 2 years later, in December 1972, Charles, Charlie Weasley, was born. The family continued to grow in 76 when Percy was born. Then, twin boys, Fred and George, were born on April Fool's Day in 1978. Ronald, or Ron Weasley, was born on March 1st, 1980, shortly followed by Arthur and Molly's first daughter, Geneva Ginny Weasley, in August 1981. The Weasley family was not wealthy in the sense that their bank vault was filled with tons of galleons and jewels, but they were rich in a different way. They built a home filled with love. Every child had things of their own, even if it was a bit worn down. They each had their own space in the house. There were even family times and home-cooked meals. While they didn't always have everything they wanted, they have everything they needed. Arthur and Molly made a home that never felt like they were just getting by. It was a warm, welcoming, comfortable home. In 1981, the same year Ginny was born, Molly lost her two brothers to Death Eaters. Fabian and Gideon were members of the Order of the Phoenix, a group of witches and wizards fighting the war against Voldemort's dark magic and his Death Eater followers. It is unknown whether the brothers ever got a chance to meet their only niece. A temporary peace fell over the wizarding world when it was believed that Voldemort was defeated in October of 1981. The following September, Bill, who was Arthur and Molly's first son, attended Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry, just as they did. In fact, over the years, all seven would attend, and they would all be sorted into the same house of Gryffindor. Arthur and Molly were incredibly happy parents with Bill's performance at Hogwarts. He was a very dedicated student who would go on to get 12 OWLs in his exams. They never questioned him about how he had achieved such marks, as it's way more than the typical class load. They were just proud parents to a gifted son. Bill would go on to work for Gringotts Wizarding Bank as a curse breaker in Egypt. Their next son, Charlie, while at Hogwarts, would become the Gryffindor Seeker on the Quidditch team. At one point during school, he gave Arthur and Molly a fright. He failed his apparition test when he materialized 5 miles south of his target. Apparition can be a dangerous thing that could lead to becoming lost or severely injured. Luckily for Molly's sanity, he passed the second time. While many thought Charlie would have become a professional Quidditch player, he would go on to study dragons in Romania after graduating. Their third son, Percy, was a very serious wizard. He had big ambitions to do well in school and join the ministry. While in school, Percy would become a prefect and head boy. He would also achieve 12 OWLs like his older brother Bill. He gave Molly such joy in all of his school achievements. After Hogwarts, Percy began working for the Ministry of Magic in the International Magical Cooperation, and later he was the junior assistant to the Minister for Magic. The twins, Fred and George, liked to keep Molly and Arthur on their toes. They were the pranksters of the family, though it was not all fun and games. One day, when they were around 7, they convinced Ron to make an unbreakable vow. Breaking an unbreakable vow would lead to death. Thankfully, Arthur found them and stopped them in time. Fred later jokes that his left buttocks was never the same because of how angry Arthur was that day. While at Hogwarts, Fred and George weren't the best in their school studies, but they had their own ambitions. After leaving Hogwarts early, they opened their successful store in Diagon Alley, selling pranks, potions, pets, and more. Ron and Ginny also kept their parents on their toes, though it was for different reasons than Fred and George. A second wizarding war was starting, and Ron and Ginny often seemed too close to the danger at such a young age. In 1991, Molly took Ron, Fred, George, Percy, and Ginny to King's Cross Station to drop off her sons at the Hogwarts Express. While rushing her kids to the station, a young lost wizard overheard Molly talking about muggles and looking for the platform. This young wizard was Harry Potter. She showed him kindness while wondering why he was all alone. She taught him how to get to the platform and allowed him to go in front of her son Ron, who was also a first year. You can see that Molly and Arthur raised their kids right when Fred and George offered to help Harry with his trunk. When they realized who he was, they wondered if he remembered being attacked by Voldemort when he was a baby. As a mother, Molly got very stern with her boys, telling them not to bother him with questions like that. Ginny, who was too young to start school that year, was fascinated by seeing Harry Potter. Ron ends up sitting with Harry on the train, and they would become fast friends. Luckily for both of them, they were sorted into Gryffindor. Molly would take Ginny home after sending off her boys. She would write letters to her son to keep in contact throughout the school year. One of the letters Ron wrote to her mentioned Harry, and said that Harry would be staying alone at Hogwarts for Christmas break, and he didn't think he'd be getting any presents. Hating the thought that Harry would wake up on Christmas with nothing, she began knitting him one of her famous Weasley sweaters. She would also send him some homemade fudge. Harry ended up not being alone in the castle that Christmas, as Ron, Fred, George, and Percy would stay behind with him. This was a small kindness the Weasley family felt like they could do for him. Molly and Arthur would take Ginny to visit Charlie in Romania for the holidays, since the other boys were staying at Hogwarts. After the school year was over, Molly would pick up all of her children. Harry would thank Molly again for the gifts, which she said was no trouble at all. Molly would try to engage with the Dursleys, Harry's guardians, who just walked away from her. She probably had a better understanding at the moment of why Ron thought Harry wouldn't get any Christmas presents. That summer break was filled with Ginny talking nonstop about meeting Harry Potter. I'm sure Molly got a kick out of her daughter's first crush until she wouldn't let up. Ron tried to write Harry several times over the summer, but wasn't getting any responses. Molly and Arthur were going to allow him to visit. Unknown to them, Harry was locked in his bedroom and wasn't getting any of their letters. One morning, Molly woke up to find beds empty, car gone, and no note of where her sons had gone. Fred, George, and Ron had decided to steal Arthur's enchanted Ford Anguilla and get Harry themselves. Molly was furious with them, but didn't fault Harry for her son's decision. She made them all breakfast and then had them de-gnome the garden as a punishment. Arthur was excited and amused to hear that the car actually flew until he read the room and saw how upset Molly was. Arthur and Molly welcomed Harry to stay with them until school started. Arthur loved to sit next to Harry during mealtimes so he could talk about things in the muggle world, like plugs and the postal service. All of the children, including Harry, received their Hogwarts letter with a supply list they needed for the upcoming year. Arthur and Molly would take the children to Diagon Alley to do all of their shopping. The Weasleys usually traveled there by flu powder, but Harry had never done this before. Arthur and Molly would explain to Harry how the system worked and showed him what to do. Unfortunately, Harry did get a bit lost, causing Molly to become frantic. But luckily, it didn't take long to reunite. The Weasleys would also run into Hermione Granger, who was one of Ron and Harry's friends from Hogwarts. Arthur was pleased to meet her and her muggle parents. He was very excited to take a look at their muggle money. Molly would take Ginny off to get her school robes, and Arthur insisted on taking the Grangers to the Leaky Cauldron for a drink. Everyone would meet up later inside Flourish and Blotts to get their school books. Inside Flourish and Blotts, a famed writer and adventurer, Gilderoy Lockhart, was having a book signing event. Arthur Weasley would run into Lucius Malfoy, father to Draco, a student in Ron's ear. Lucius insults the Weasley family, and Arthur becomes furious. Arthur threw himself at Lucius, causing a scene in the bookstore. Eventually, they would be pulled apart, with Arthur receiving a cut lip. Molly was incredibly embarrassed by Arthur's behavior, especially in front of Gilderoy Lockhart. On the night before the kids return to school, Molly makes a lavish dinner. They had a display of filibuster fireworks and concluded the night with hot chocolate. The following day was quite chaotic. Molly and Arthur had to ensure 6 kids would be ready to head out to King's Cross Station. Once the car was packed, they started on their way. Unfortunately, they had to turn back 3 times for items someone had forgotten. Arthur wanted to use the flying function on the car, saying it would be faster, but Molly shot down the idea. Everyone rushed to the platform when they arrived at King's Cross Station. Due to some crazy event, Harry and Ron couldn't make it through the platform entrance. They were blocked. Panicked, they decided to take Arthur's car and fly to Hogwarts. Not only were they spotted flying by muggles, they also crashed the car into the Whomping Willow Tree at Hogwarts. The vehicle then drove off into the Forbidden Forest. Molly and Arthur were furious with what Ron did. Molly sent him a howler, or a shouting letter, to Ron the next morning during breakfast. She spoke of how upset they were and the fright when they found them not on the platform and the car gone. She thought Arthur would die of shame when they got a letter from Dumbledore explaining what happened. This wasn't the way she raised him. An act like this could have gotten them killed. They were absolutely disgusted. Arthur was going to be facing an inquiry at work for the enchantment of the car. Needless to say, neither of them were happy over the event. Putting the car issue behind them, things settled down for Arthur and Molly while the kids were at school. This would be the first time they had the house to themselves in ages. They enjoyed how relaxing it was until they got bad news from Hogwarts. The Chamber of Secrets within Hogwarts was opened, and students were being attacked. Their daughter Ginny had been taken into the chamber, and Ron and Harry went after her. Arthur and Molly rushed to the school to wait for the news and find out if her kids and Harry were okay. With a mixture of bravery, skills, and luck, all 3 would return safely. Harry would explain as much as he could about what happened, and Dumbledore would elaborate further. Ginny had been possessed by a diary of a teenage version of Voldemort. Molly was stunned by all of this information. A bit shocked, Arthur said, "Haven't I taught you anything? What have I always told you? Never trust anything that can think for itself if you can't see where it keeps its brain." Molly and Arthur would escort Ginny to the hospital wing for some rest. The end of the school year came, and everyone would board the Hogwarts Express home. Arthur and Molly would pick up their children for the summer and try to comfort them after the year's events. Even though they would act as if it was all well, they both knew deep down there was a fear of Voldemort's return, possibly leading to a second wizarding war. Over the summer, Arthur Weasley would win the Daily Prophet Grand Prize Galleon Draw. This was an annual lottery draw for a prize of 700 galleons. Arthur and Molly decided it would be nice to use the winnings to plan a family trip to Egypt to visit Bill. They would take the tours of different pyramids. However, Molly refused to let Ginny in the last one, as it was full of things deemed too scary for her. They returned home shortly before the start of school. Arthur had learned of some frightening news while at work. Sirius Black, a prisoner, had escaped from what was considered an unescapable prison, Azkaban. It was thought that his target would be Harry Potter, as he was overheard muttering, "He's at Hogwarts," in his sleep. Sirius Black was in prison for allegedly attacking several muggles and killing a former friend, Peter Pettigrew. He was also thought to be the secret keeper of the Potter's location. This location was later revealed to Voldemort, causing the death of Harry's parents, Lily and James. Arthur and Molly debated over telling Harry the truth of the matter. Molly didn't want Harry to go to Hogwarts with the idea hanging over his head. She was convinced he would be safe at Hogwarts under Dumbledore's watch. However, Arthur thought if Sirius could break out of Azkaban, he could surely find a way into Hogwarts. Harry had overheard Arthur and Molly discussing Sirius, but they didn't know it at the time. When taking everyone to King's Cross Station, Arthur would pull Harry aside to speak with him. Harry had told him that he knew what was going on and wasn't scared, but Arthur warned him not to go looking for Black. This school year, Hogwarts was being watched by Dementors, the soul-sucking guards of Azkaban. Even with the Dementors there, Sirius Black would make it inside Hogwarts. Not only did he make it inside the castle, but inside the Gryffindor boys' dormitory, where he would attack Ron's pet, Scabbers. As it turns out, Sirius Black was not guilty of the crimes he was sentenced to. Peter Pettigrew was the actual criminal. He switched to the dark side and gave up the Potter's location. He also attacked the Muggles and cut off his finger to stage the crime. Peter was an animagus, a wizard who could transform into an animal. Sirius Black and James Potter were also animagus. They learned how to transform so they would be with their friend Remus Lupin, a werewolf, when he changed once a month. Peter Pettigrew was hiding with the Weasley family for years without them knowing. He stayed in his rat form, becoming the family pet. Sirius had seen the Weasleys' family photo in the Daily Prophet when they had won the lottery and recognized Peter in the image. Even after uncovering the truth, Sirius had to continue to hide after all this time because Peter had gotten away. In the public's eye, he would continue to be a criminal, but Arthur and Molly now knew the truth about him. When the summer came, Arthur got tickets from someone at work for his family to attend the Quidditch World Cup. They would invite Harry, who had become like a son to them, to join. They would also send an invitation to Hermione Granger. Molly had written her first letter by mail post to ask the Dursleys if Harry could come. She filled the whole envelope with stamps, not knowing how many she needed. Ron also sent a letter, but with an owl, letting him know they would come pick him up no matter what the Dursley said. Arthur would travel via the flu network to pick up Harry for the game. Unknown to him, the Dursleys had boarded up their fireplace to add an electric one. Arthur, Fred, George, and Ron would all get stuck in the chimney. They had to blast their way out of it. The Dursleys did not like this one bit. Arthur was very apologetic on the matter, especially after the twins had purposely dropped a prank candy that Dudley, the Dursley son, ate, causing his tongue to grow a ridiculous length. He offered to fix everything before he returned home. Arthur, Fred, George, Ron, Ginny, Harry, and Hermione would all travel using a portkey, a muggle item under a transportation spell, to get to the Quidditch World Cup. They were also accompanied by Amos Diggory and his son, Cedric. Bill, Charlie, and Percy also went, but they chose to apparate since they were all of age. When they arrived, Arthur had to pay muggle money for the campsite. Harry helped him to understand which notes were correct, showing that this was probably Arthur's first time paying with muggle money. Once at their campsite, Harry and Hermione helped Arthur set up two tents for the 10 of them to stay in. There was a larger one for the boys and a slightly smaller one for the girls. Arthur was rather excited to use the mallet to spike down the tents. The group would run into several people that Arthur knew, including Ludo Bagman. Ludo was the reason Arthur was able to get the tickets to the Quidditch World Cup. Arthur had previously helped Otto Bagman, Ludo's brother, to get out of a situation with a magically enchanted lawnmower. Ludo was going around the campsites, seeing if anyone wanted to place bets on the match. Arthur would put up a galleon, but his twin sons, Fred and George, would put up their savings of 37 galleons, 15 sickles, 3 canuts, and a trick wand. They all would watch the game from the top box, which could arguably be the best seats in the house. It was filled with several important wizards. It was a rather exciting game, with Bulgaria scoring 160 and Ireland 170. Fred and George rushed to collect their winnings from Ludo, but Arthur made sure to mention not to tell their mother about gambling. Arthur was rather curious about the big plans Fred and George had for their money, but decided it was best not to know. After the game, they would all head back to their campsite for a cup of cocoa before going to bed. Once everyone was fast asleep, Arthur would shout for everyone to wake back up. Death Eaters were running around the campsites, causing havoc. Arthur would tell all the underage children under his care to head towards the forest to hide. Arthur, Bill, Charlie, and Percy all headed into the chaos to try to help. Someone would set off the dark mark in the sky, causing even more fear among everyone there. Arthur and several wizards would come upon Harry, Ron, and Hermione, thinking that one of them might have set off the mark, but Arthur protects all three. The situation was then blamed on Barty Crouch's house elf, Winky, whom he promptly freed from her duties to the Crouch family. Arthur took everyone back to their tents to get a few hours of sleep before they could find an earlier port key to get back home. When they returned home, Molly had been waiting in the front yard, clutching the Daily Prophet. She had read about what happened in the paper and was incredibly worried for her family. After rounds of hugs, they settled back inside the house. Arthur would read over the article in the Daily Prophet that Rita Skeeter wrote. Rita was a reporter who tended to stir up drama when possible when with her writing. Even though Arthur was on a break from work, he knew he would have to go into the ministry to help sort things out. Molly clearly didn't want Arthur to go. She probably just wanted some time to feel that her family was safe at home, even just for a moment. Over the next week, Arthur had spent extra time in the office, and Molly remarks that he hadn't had to work over the weekends since the days of you-know-who. Even though Rita hadn't mentioned Arthur in the article, it was he who made the passing comment to her that she used to stir up the article. At the end of the summer, Arthur got an urgent message from the ministry. Amos Diggory's head appeared in the Weasley's fireplace. He called on Arthur because Alistair Moody, aka Mad-Eye, caused a scene at his home the night prior. One of his muggle neighbors even called the police because of all the noise. Amos hoped that Arthur could help him get off charges because he was supposed to start a new job the next day. Since Arthur was out helping Alistair, Molly was going to have to get all the children to King's Cross Station by herself. Molly would use the telephone at a nearby village post to order three taxis to take them and their luggage to the train station. Arthur had tried to get the ministry to lend them a car. They didn't have any to spare at the time. Bill and Charlie ended up joining Molly to see everyone off at Hogwarts. As everyone was saying their goodbyes, Charlie made a comment that he would be seeing them sooner than they thought, but left it as that with a wisp of mystery. Molly even comments about them not wanting to come home for Christmas with everything happening at Hogwarts this year. Unknown to all the students boarding the Hogwarts Express, they would experience a Tri-Wizard tournament this year, an event that hasn't happened for several years. After the train pulls out, Molly and her two eldest sons disapparate back to the Burrow. Harry's name would come out of the Goblet of Fire, the device to determine the worthy champions for the tournament. Molly got incredibly upset when she found this out. She thought all of her children, including Harry, would be safe because there was an age limit, but somehow Harry had to compete. Rita Skeeter was covering the tournament for the Daily Prophet. Molly would read it at any chance she could for updates, and when she read that Harry still cried for his parents, it made her cry too. Unfortunately, Rita wrote several lies and Molly fell into the trap. This caused her normal Easter gift to them to reflect her disappointment in Hermione. Of course, this all got cleared up eventually, and Molly would feel bad about it. For the third task of the tournament, Molly and her eldest Bill would travel to Hogwarts to support Harry. Harry was very surprised to see both of them. The three got to spend some time together, and Harry showed them around the school. Molly was interested in the Whomping Willow, since it was planted after her time at school. She was really enjoying the trip down memory lane being there. They got to enjoy a grand feast together before Harry had to take off to complete the third task. Molly and Bill would join everyone at the Quidditch field to watch the final task of the tournament. Unknown to everyone, Voldemort and his Death Eaters had been pulling strings the whole time, and the final task was a setup. Harry's blood would be used against his will to bring Voldemort back to full power. Cedric Diggory, who was another Triwizard champion, was killed, but Harry managed to escape. As it turns out, when Arthur was helping out Alistair Moody months ago, right before the school year started, he was unknowingly helping Barty Crouch Jr. get away with a crime. Barty Jr. had attacked Moody in his home and had locked him up in a trunk. He then used Polyjuice Potion to trick everyone for months that he was Alistair, the new Defense Against the Dark Arts professor, and not a Death Eater who was supposed to be locked up in Azkaban. After Barty Crouch Jr. was exposed and Dumbledore had Harry explain everything to him, Harry was taken up to the hospital wing where Molly was looking for him. She was so frightened for him, not knowing what happened and where he had been taken. When she saw him, she ran right for him, but Dumbledore blocked her and explained that he needed some quiet and rest for a while. Molly's eyes filled with tears as she was so worried for Harry, but thankful he seemed to be okay at the same time. All she wanted to do was give him any comfort she could. She stayed by his side throughout the night. At some point, the Minister for Magic, Fudge, burst into the room. A fuss was being made over him allowing a Dementor to give Barty Crouch Jr. a kiss that sucked out his soul. This meant that the evidence they had that Voldemort was back was destroyed. Harry was awoken by all the noise and shouted that he did see Voldemort, that he was back, and could name off all of his Death Eaters. He tried to get out of bed, but Molly kept him down, wanting to protect him and knowing he needed rest. She would keep one hand on his shoulder in case he tried to get up again. After Fudge leaves, Dumbledore turns to Molly and asks if he can count on her and Arthur. While she was scared, she was resolute when she responded, "Of course you can." Dumbledore wanted to get the news of what just happened to Arthur, so Bill volunteered to go. He needed Arthur to spread the word of the truth to others they could count on. What the others in the room didn't know was that Dumbledore was asking Molly if she would join him this time around to be part of the Order of the Phoenix. This was the group of witches and wizards who fought against Voldemort and his Death Eaters during the First Wizarding War. Molly's two brothers were part of the original group and had lost their lives fighting in the war. With Bill off to talk to Arthur, Molly stayed with Harry in the hospital wing. She got him to take more potion to help him sleep and put her arms around him. Though he didn't say it out loud, Harry thought he had never been hugged the way that Molly was hugging him. It was like a mother hugging her son, filled with love and care. The next morning, Molly would have a meeting with Dumbledore. She wanted to ask if Harry could come home with her instead of sending him back to the Dursleys. Knowing that Harry had a special protection placed on him from his mother's sacrifice, Dumbledore told Molly that he needed to return to the Dursleys, if only for a little while. Molly would head back home, and all of the students would prepare for their journey back on the Hogwarts Express. When Molly sees Harry, she would give him another hug and let him know that he can come to them later in the summer. Roughly a week into the summer, Arthur and Percy would get into an argument. Percy was promoted at the ministry to junior assistant to the minister. It was an amazing promotion for someone of Percy's age, but Arthur thought that he might have gotten the promotion so he could spy on their family and Dumbledore. The minister didn't want people on Dumbledore's side, as he didn't want everyone to believe that Voldemort was back. Fudge wanted to live in a false sense of safety. He also suspected that Arthur might be under Dumbledore's wing, but couldn't prove it. The argument would end with Percy leaving the house and moving into a flat in London. Molly was put into such a state after he left. She would cry when she thinks of him or if anyone mentions his name. She even tried to visit him once, but Percy just slammed the door in her face. Not only was Percy proud of his promotion, but he was upset with his father because he didn't seem to believe in him, and he was only promoted for ulterior motives. Percy also believes everything in the Daily Prophet, and lately, they have been quietly trying to discredit Harry and make him seem like he was an attention-seeking child. Not long after Percy left the Burrow, Arthur and Molly would pack up their children and temporarily move to 12 Grimmauld Place. This was the home of Sirius Black. He was the last male of the Black family line, so he inherited the place. They turned it into the headquarters for the Order of the Phoenix. Arthur, Molly, and other new and returning members would gather to have meetings about their plan to deal with the second coming of Voldemort. Harry would also join them all there about a month into the summer. On the night Harry arrives, he spots a map of a building still laying out. Molly would quickly try to pick it up and put it away as she didn't want the younger ones to be a part of what they were doing. The same night, Sirius would ask Harry why he hadn't asked what was going on, to which he replied he did. he asked Ron and Hermione. Since they weren't in the Order, they didn't have much they could say on what has been happening. Sirius thought that since he was Harry's godfather, it was his right to decide whether Harry could know things or not. This, of course, angered Molly. She always thought of Harry as a son and didn't think it should be up to Sirius to decide what was good for Harry. Molly ends up going full Mama Bear on Sirius over it, being very protective over Harry. With Arthur and Lupin weighing in, there was an agreement that Harry could be told some things, but everyone else underage had to leave the room. Molly tried to have Fred and George leave too, but since they were of age, she folded and let them stay. Ron and Hermione were also allowed to remain, since Harry would tell them everything anyway. It ended up only being Ginny made to leave, and Molly would walk her up to bed. They would explain some things that have happened with Voldemort, including that he was looking for something like a weapon he didn't have last time. Molly comes back at the moment that Harry asks what kind of weapon, but stops the conversation from going any further. She tells them again that they should all head off to bed, and one by one, they stood and left the room. Arthur would continue to go to work at the ministry and try to stay under the radar, and Molly would stay at Grimmauld Place, working on cleaning up the house with the children. While cleaning, Molly thinks she's found a bogger in an old writing desk, but waits until she can speak with Alistair before opening it. With his special eye, he could see inside the desk without needing to open it first. After several days had passed, Arthur needed to take Harry into the ministry with him. Harry had a hearing for using magic in front of a muggle earlier that summer. When Harry was still at the Dursleys, Dementors attacked him and Dudley. Harry would use a Patronus charm to dispel them, but got a notice from the ministry. He would need to attend a hearing to determine if he was allowed back at Hogwarts or if his wand would be broken. Arthur was rather excited about their journey to the ministry that day, as he was taking Harry the non-magical route. They would be going on the underground train. After a couple of stops, they would get off and head towards an old red telephone booth. This would take them into the ministry after dialing the proper number. Arthur would take Harry through the ministry until they reached his office. A few minutes after settling in, a wizard pops into his office with an urgent message. Harry's hearing was moved to a different room and a much earlier in time. In fact, they needed to be there 5 minutes ago. They rushed off to the meeting. When they reached the courtroom 10, Arthur sent Harry in alone. Even though Dumble arrived shortly after them, Arthur was still very nervous for Harry. He waited outside the room until the doors finally opened. Dumbledore left first, but didn't say anything to him. But when Harry emerged, he told him that he was clear of all charges, and he would be able to return to Hogwarts again. As the rest of the courtroom cleared, Percy Weasley came through the doors. He was the court scribe during the hearing. Still mad at his father, Percy just walked right past them without even a glance. This hurt Arthur deeply, but he tried his best not to show it. Arthur and Harry would head out of the ministry, with Arthur saying he would drop Harry off on his way to deal with a jinxed toilet in Bethnal Green. Before they made it out, they ran into Lucius Malfoy. Lucius claimed he was there to have a private word with Fudge, but Arthur didn't quite believe that. He made a mental note to make sure Dumbledore knew. When Harry arrived back, everyone was so excited for him. Molly had to wipe her face with her apron to clean her eyes from the tears of joy. With the trial behind him, things could continue as they were at Grimmauld Place. Molly would have everyone help her clean up the house and make it more livable. Arthur and Molly would continue to partake in order meetings, but this time Harry and the others were left out of the conversation. On the last day of their holiday, letters from Hogwarts with their new school supply list arrived. Ron and Hermione also got prefect badges. Molly was overjoyed that Ron was chosen to be the prefect and gave him a huge hug. She promised him a gift as a reward for such an achievement. Ron asked if there was any possible way he could have a new broom. Not necessarily a good one, just a new one. With some hesitation, Molly said, "Of course he could." After adding a new broom to her list, Molly headed out to Diagon Alley to pick up everyone's school supplies while they started to pack up their school trunks. That evening, they had a little party, and Molly made a banner that read, "Congratulations, Ron and Hermione, new prefects." Several of the Order members were in attendance. Even Alistair was there. Molly finally got to ask him to check out the possible bogger in the old writing desk. And he said yes, it was, and offered to take care of it, but Molly insisted she could do it. It was a really nice dinner party filled with conversation and fun. At the end of the night, Molly decided to take care of the boggart before heading out to bed. When Harry decided to head upstairs, he heard Molly crying in the drawing room. The boggart she was going to take care of became the bodies of her family. Every time she tried to dispel it with ridiculous, it would change forms and become another family member. Harry shouted at her to get out of the room when Lupin came up to the scene. He would take care of the boggart for her. Lupin would comfort Molly, and she admits that she sees them dead all of the time. Her dreams are just nightmares filled with her loved ones dying. Molly would ask them not to tell Arthur. She didn't want him to know, but she just worried all the time with half of the family in the order. She thought it would take a miracle for everyone to come through it all. Then she thought of Percy, and what if they never got a chance to make up? Also, what would happen if she and Arthur were killed? Who would look after Ron and Ginny? Lupin would continue trying to make her feel better, and even Sirius would chime in. When the tears finally subsided, Molly would finally head off to bed. The next day, everyone head out to King's Cross Station. Molly, Arthur, and members of the Order would act as guards while traveling. It took about 20 minutes for them to make it there on foot, but they made it in time. With hugs and goodbyes, the train departed with all of the students aboard. With all of the children off at Hogwarts, Arthur and Molly continued their meetings with the Order. They, along with the other members, would take turns standing guard in the Department of Mysteries within the Ministry. They were trying to protect a prophecy about Voldemort. This was the potential weapon or thing they thought Voldemort was looking for. On one of the evenings that Arthur was standing guard, he was attacked by Voldemort's snake, Nagini. Arthur was sitting in front of the door, but was getting drowsy. While Nagini's mission was to scout out the room, she couldn't stop the urge to bite Arthur. After three horrifying bites, he slumped over in pain, his blood scattered all over the floor. Since he was not supposed to be down there, and he was the only one on guard, it didn't seem like Arthur would get out of this situation alive. However, Harry, having a connection with Voldemort and his Horcruxes, was able to see the attack in his dreams. Luckily for Arthur, Professor McGonagall and Dumbledore believed Harry, and they would send help in time. Dumbledore sent two portraits to find Arthur and bring him help. He also sent Fox, his phoenix, off to send a warning. Arthur had been found and was being taken to St. Mungo's Hospital. Dumbledore would make a portkey to send the Weasley children to Grimmauld Place. As soon as Molly found out what happened, she headed straight to the hospital. She sent word to her children to stay put, Arthur is still alive, and she will send an update as soon as she could. The following day, Molly embraces Harry, thanking him for helping save Arthur's life. Sirius invited her and her family to stay with him while Arthur was in the hospital. It was much easier to get there from Grimmauld Place than the Burrow. Some of the Order would escort Molly and the children to St. Mungo's. When they reach Arthur's room, they see he's covered in bandages. Arthur says he can go home as soon as they can take off all of the bandages, but every time they try, he starts to bleed again. His healers were trying to find an antidote or solution to what might be causing the bleed. He even had to take a blood replenishment potion every hour to keep him stable. Fred and George kept trying to ask Arthur what happened and what he was doing, where he was, but Molly kept shutting them down. She did not want them to know this, and definitely not something they should discuss in the open. Molly would shoo out the children to allow Tongs and Alistair to come see Arthur. They spoke on their search for the snake and what Nagini might have been doing down in the Ministry. They would also talk about Harry and how he was able to see what happened while he was sleeping, and that Dumbledore seemed to have been waiting for something like this to happen. The following day, back at Grimmauld Place, they decided to put up Christmas decorations. Even Sirius got into the spirit and began singing some carols. In the evening, Hermione would join them. She told her parents that she was staying at Hogwarts for the Christmas break, but she took the night bus to join the Weasleys for the holidays. While everyone seemed excited for Christmas morning, Molly was downstairs crying. She sent Percy a Christmas jumper she made, but he sent it back. It didn't even have a note attached. Fred and George tried to cheer her up, but Lupin stepped in to give her some comfort. After Christmas lunch, they decided to visit Arthur in the hospital. Lupin and Alistair would escort them. However, Mundungus, another Order member, showed up with a car. He claims he borrowed it for the occasion because the Underground didn't run on Christmas. Arthur got to spend time with his family and open gifts. Molly noticed that Arthur's bandages had been changed a day early and questioned him about it. Arthur was somewhat nervous to admit why, but the day prior, a trainee healer, Augustus Pry, had tried a muggle remedy on him. He tried stitches on his wounds, but since this was a magical wound, it did not work. On the final day of Christmas holiday, Arthur was well enough to leave St. Mungo's and make it back to Grimald Place. There was a rotating amount of the order members that stopped by the house. The next day, Tonks and Lupin would take the children on the night bus to head back to Hogwarts and give Arthur and Molly some much-needed alone time. Besides Dumbledore getting removed from his position at Hogwarts, things continued as usual for Arthur, Molly, and the Order. That was, at least for a while. Harry had another vision, like the one of Arthur, but this time it was serious. He was in trouble at the Ministry, but it was a trap for Harry. Voldemort and his Death Eaters had devised a plan to lure Harry to the Department of Mysteries to retrieve the prophecy about Harry and Voldemort. Arthur and Molly would stay behind as Sirius, Lupin, Alistair, Tonks, and Kingsley headed to the Ministry to help. Harry, Ron, Hermione, Ginny, Neville, and Luna had all traveled there and got caught up in a battle with several Death Eaters. Sadly, Sirius didn't make it out alive from this battle, but the Minister Fudge now saw proof that Voldemort was back. After returning to Hogwarts for a little while, Harry and the others were about to be on summer break again. When they arrived back at King's Cross Station, Molly was there, open arms to greet Ron and Ginny. She also pulled in Harry for a huge hug. Several of the Order members were also there. Arthur would approach the Dursleys with Alistair. They gave a warning to treat Harry better. Tonks and Lupin would join in on the warning too. Molly would tell Harry that they will get him away from there as soon as possible. That summer, the Minister for Magic, Fudge, would be removed from office and a new minister, Rufus Scrimgeour, who used to be the head of the Aura Department, was hired. Scrimgeour would promote Arthur to the head office for the detection and confiscation of counterfeit defensive spells and protective objects. Albus Dumbledore would travel to Privet Drive to pick up Harry from the Dursleys to bring him over to the Weasleys. Before making their way to the Burrow, they would make a pit stop. Dumbledore wanted Harry's help recruiting Horace Slughorn to return to teach at Hogwarts again. It had been many years since he retired. He even taught Molly and Arthur back when they were students. When Harry arrived at the Burrow, Molly would make Harry some food and chat with him while everyone else was still asleep. When Arthur came home from work, he pressured Molly to make sure that it was him. They had a new security measure of asking questions that only the real version of the person could know. Molly would ask Arthur what his dearest ambition was, and Arthur would reply to find out how airplanes stay up. Then Arthur would ask, "What do you like me to call you when we're all alone?" Molly got rather embarrassed because Harry was sitting right there, but she would reply in a whisper, "Molly Wobbles." Harry would let out a yawn, and Molly would take him up to bed. She set him up in Fred and George's old room. Fred and George had opened a joke shop that was doing very well, and they were now staying in a flat above the shop. Molly and Arthur would catch up for a bit before going to bed themselves. Fleur Delacour was also staying at the Burrow with the Weasleys. She was also in the Triwizard Tournament, like Harry. Fleur had met Bill when he and Molly came to watch the third task in the tournament. They had fallen in love and were getting married. Molly was not thrilled about this. She thought the two were rushing into getting married because Voldemort was back. She knew that many people had done that during the First Wizarding War. While Molly wasn't a fan of Fleur, she disapproved of when Ginny would call her Flem behind her back. Several weeks would pass by, and they tried to make it as pleasant of a holiday as they could, with also dealing with the news of disappearances, accidents, and even deaths. They even tried to have a birthday gathering for Harry, but it was filled with gloom. Molly would try to change the subject when they started talking about the news during the birthday tea, but there was no stopping it. The time would come when they needed to get new school supplies, and Arthur would get a car from the Ministry. They would also meet up with Hagrid at the Leaky Cauldron as a bit of extra security when they shopped. With great hesitation for Molly, the group split up to try and get the shopping done faster. After they got everything they needed, both groups met back up. Together, they headed down to Fred and George's shop, Weasley's Wizard Weasleys. In the window, there was a huge banner that read, "Why are you worrying about you-know-who? You should be worrying about you-know-poo, the constipation sensation that's gripping the nation." The sign made Molly worry that they would be murdered in their sleep for that slogan. Their store is filled with a wide range of items from daydream charms to muggle magic tricks. They even had a room of protective and spycraft items. Molly and Ginny spent some time looking at a pet pygmy puff, and Arthur was fascinated by a pack of muggle playing cards. Over the last week of the holiday, Molly became increasingly irritable with having to listen to Flora's plans for her and Bill's wedding. Even after spending the summer together, Molly still didn't approve of Flora. She thought she was snobbish and a bit rude. When the time came, they would all take ministry cars to King's Cross Station to drop off Ron, Ginny, Harry, and Hermione so they could catch the Hogwarts Express and go back to school. Two auras would also meet them there for extra security. Before Harry got on the train, he would ask Arthur for a word. Harry warns Arthur that he thinks Draco Malfoy has been branded a Death Eater to replace his father Lucius. Even though Arthur wasn't sure about what Harry was saying to him, he said he would look into it, then rushed him off to catch the train before it left. Christmas time would come around, and everyone would gather back at the Burrow. Molly had set up the house and prepared dinner for a large group. Arthur had to put in extra hours at the ministry until Christmas Eve night. When he finally makes it home, Harry once again tries to speak to him about Draco, but this time he thinks Snape is also involved with whatever Draco is planning. Lupin would jump into the conversation and urge him to trust Dumbledore. If Dumbledore says Snape is on their side, he should believe him. During their dinner, Molly was hit with a shock. She shot out of her chair when she saw her son Percy outside the window. He was walking up to the house with the minister. When the doors opened and Percy came in, Molly ran over to him and threw her arms around him and gave him a huge hug. The minister claimed that Percy wanted to see his family so badly that they had to stop by, but Percy had a pretty stone face towards them. In truth, the minister just wanted a private word with Harry to try to recruit him to be the poster boy for the ministry. The night didn't end the way Molly had hoped. Seeing Percy gave her so much joy, but he left in a huff after Fred, George, and Ginny had hit him in the face with mashed parsnips. This caused Molly to fall back into tears over him. The day would come when the children needed to return to Hogwarts, and Molly was still constantly in tears. She worried about sending them off and was still distraught over Percy. Unknown to Arthur and Molly, they would end up seeing their children sooner than they thought. In March, Ron accidentally ate chocolates spiked with a love potion. It was originally given to Harry, but he tossed them away. Ron claimed that he found them, thinking that someone had left them for him since it was his birthday. Harry would take Ron to Slughorn to try to get help for Ron. Once the potion effects wore off, Slughorn offered the boys a drink. Ron was the first to drink, and instantly, they all knew it was poisoned. Slughorn was in shock, but luckily, Harry thought quickly and shoved a Beezar in his mouth to counteract the poison. Arthur and Molly would travel to Hogwarts as soon as they were told about what happened. They would stay by his side in the hospital wing until others were allowed in, and they would step away momentarily to have a word with Dumbledore. When they returned to the hospital ward, Molly would go right up to Harry and give him a tight hug. Molly would thank him for not only saving Ron, but also for saving Arthur and Ginny. Arthur also made a comment that it was a lucky day for the Weasleys when Ron decided to sit in Harry's compartment on the Hogwarts Express. Ron would recover just fine, and Arthur and Molly would head home. However, again, they would end up seeing their children far sooner than they thought. Harry's fears that Draco was up to something turned into a reality. Draco had helped sneak Death Eaters into Hogwarts. There was an attack on the school, Bill was bitten by a werewolf, and Dumbledore was killed. Bill was a bit lucky, though, as Fenrir Greyback was not transformed into his wolf form when he was attacked. Bill would end up with a scar for the rest of his life and picked up a few wolfish traits, but he wouldn't transform. Arthur and Molly would travel to Hogwarts immediately. When they arrived, Molly ran past everyone to be by Bill's side. She gave him a kiss on his forehead and sat next to him and cried. She had commented that it doesn't matter how he looks, but he was a very handsome boy, and that he was going to be married. Fleur took offense to this comment. She said it would take more than a werewolf bite to make Bill stop loving her and want to marry her. Molly had thought with his wounds and how he looked, Fleur would no longer want him, but she was wrong. Fleur said she was good-looking enough for the both of them, and that scars will show that her husband is a brave man. Molly finally understood why they were together and started to warm up to Fleur. She even offered to lend their great-aunt Muriel's tiara to her for their wedding. It was in that moment they both started crying and hugging each other. Arthur and Molly would stay at Hogwarts to be near Bill and to attend Dumbledore's funeral. It was summer again, and Harry had to return to Privet Drive one last time. The Order of the Phoenix had set up security measures to get Harry safely to the Burrow. Two members of the Order would take the Dursleys to safety, and several others would help with a plan to pick up Harry. They would use Polyjuice Potion so half of the group would look like Harry and to confuse any Death Eaters that might attack. Alistair was paired up with Mundungus, Arthur with Fred, Lupin with George, Bill with Fleur, Kingsley with Hermione, Tonks with Ron, and Hagrid with Harry. The plan was for each pair to travel by air to one location, then transport to the Burrow. Hagrid and Harry were the first to arrive at the Burrow, and Molly rushed out to greet them. She wanted to know what happened and where everyone else was. He let her know that Death Eaters did attack and things got messy. Hagrid asked Molly for a drink to calm his nerves, and she ran back inside the house to fetch him one. She could have magically summoned it, but she needed a moment to hide her face from the fear she was feeling. Hagrid and Harry were supposed to be the third group back. Arthur, Fred, Ron, and Tonks should have already arrived, but the Portkeys showed up without them. Lupin and George were next to arrive. George was unconscious and had been hit with a curse that blasted off one of his ears. They carried him in the Burrow, and Molly was instantly by his side. She and Ginny started to tend to his wound. They got the bleeding to stop, but there was a gaping hole where his ear should have been. Then Kingsley and Hermione showed up. There was some discussion on what happened and if there was a traitor or a fake in the group when Arthur and Fred appeared. He ran past everyone to get inside to see George and make sure he was okay. With his father and twin brother now by his side, George started to wake. Molly would ask him how he's feeling, to which he replied, "Saint-like, because he's holy." With still having a sense of humor, Molly cried even harder in relief that he would be just fine. Ron and Tonks finally arrived in a bit of a daze. Ginny checked in with her brother before running back inside to tell Molly and Arthur that Ron was back and okay. All three quickly came back outside the house to embrace Ron. Within a few minutes, Bill and Fleur arrived. As Molly ran up to them to hug her son, Bill would look beyond her towards Arthur and said, "Mad-Eye's dead." He told everyone how Mundungus freaked out and disapparated, leaving Alistair alone. Voldemort has shot a curse right at them and hit Alistair in the face, sending him backwards off of his broom. Without anyone else to wait to arrive, everyone slowly and silently followed Arthur and Molly back inside the house. Once inside, without knowing what to do next, they all had a drink of fire whiskey, held their glasses high, and saluted Mad-Eye. Bill and Lupin would head out shortly to try and recover Alistair's body before the Death Eaters do. Molly hoped that Bill would stay, but it was an important task he needed to do. Harry would also try and say he was leaving the house, but Molly shut him down. The events of tonight happened to get Harry there safely. Laura even agreed to have their wedding there instead of in France to keep things near home and safe. Arthur would also jump in, telling him he shouldn't go. Harry would stay, and it was a rough night's sleep for everyone. A sense of shock and gloom hung over the house for the next few days, but everyone tried their best to keep moving forward. Harry's birthday and Bill and Fleur's wedding were right around the corner. Molly knew that Harry, Ron, and Hermione were up to something, but didn't know what it was. She had taken it upon herself to corner each of them to try to figure out what they were planning. Since the three of them were planning not to return to Hogwarts, Molly felt like she and Arthur had the right to know why they were abandoning their education. She didn't understand how Dumbledore had a mission for Harry that the Order couldn't have taken care of. In an effort to try to keep the three from planning whatever it was they were about to do, she tried to keep them busy with preparing for the wedding. One of the tasks before the wedding was to muck out the chickens, which Molly assigned to Harry. Arthur would go with him to the chicken coop where he had been hiding Sirius's old motorbike. He wanted to learn how it worked and fix it up again. But he asked Harry to keep it a secret from Molly because he didn't think she would approve. 2 days before the wedding, the Delacour family would arrive at the Burrow. With the added security measures on the house, Arthur had to meet them on a hill nearby so no one could travel within their protections. The next day was Harry's 17th birthday. Molly had gifted Harry a gold watch. It used to be her brother Fabian's. In return, Harry gave her a big hug filled with love and thanks. There was a birthday dinner for Harry outside in the garden. Molly had also invited Lupin, Tonks, and Hagrid to join the family in celebration. Shortly after Molly added a large birthday cake that looked like a Quidditch snitch to the table, Arthur would send a message via Patronus. The Minister for Magic was traveling with him home. Before the minister arrived, Lupin and Tonks ran off from the party without explanation. Arthur was rather nervous about the minister wanting to speak alone with Harry, Ron, and Hermione, but he offered them the sitting room for their conversation. The minister was there because Dumbledore had left a few things to them in his will. After the items were discussed, the conversation got a little heated. Arthur and Molly would burst into the room since they heard raised voices. After the minister left, they would carry on with Harry's birthday dinner before calling it a night. They all needed a good night's rest before the wedding. It was a beautiful wedding filled with love and tears of joy. Then the reception was filled with food, dancing, and happy conversations. That is, until Kingsley sent a Patronus message. The ministry has fallen. Scrimgeour is dead. They are coming. The sound of everyone dancing and having fun fell silent, and then someone screamed. All of the protections around the burrow had broken, and everyone was sprinting in different directions. Several people were able to escape before the Death Eaters arrived. Between Arthur, Molly, and the remaining Order members at the wedding, everyone was safe. Arthur would send a Patronus message to Ron to let them know that they were okay, but do not reply in case they were being watched. As the Weasleys were a pure-blood family, they didn't go into hiding like many of the other families when the Death Eaters took over the ministry. Arthur would even still go to work each day. The Death Eaters knew that Harry was on the run after the wedding, but they thought that Ron was back home sick. They transformed their house rule to trick anyone looking for Ron. It was better for the Death Eaters to watch out for the Weasleys than attack, just in case they could lure Harry back to one of them. Arthur would run into Harry one day at work, but he didn't know it was him. Just like last time Arthur saw him, Harry was under Polyjuice's potion, but this time as a ministry employee. Harry, Ron, and Hermione had broken in to try to retrieve the Horcrux locket. Harry would warn Arthur that the ministry had a file on him, that it was marked down as blood traitor. Arthur thought it was a threat, not knowing it was Harry, but either way, he was informed that his family was being watched. Then the time would come when the Death Eaters figured out that Ron was with Harry Potter and not at home sick. A group of snatchers found them in the woods and took them to the Malfoy Manor. Dobby, the house elf, was helping transport the prisoners to safety at Bill and Flora's house. Bill would then alert Arthur and Molly and had them move to the great aunt Muriel's house. Arthur would become a secret keeper of her home, and Bill was the secret keeper of his and Flora's house. Now that they were in hiding, Arthur was no longer safe to return to work. However, they wouldn't be there for long as the Wizarding War was about to reach its peak. Voldemort was on his way to Hogwarts to find Harry. Harry was able to sneak in with Ron and Hermione through a hidden passageway from the Hog's Head Inn into the Room of Requirement. The Room of Requirement was filled with Dumbledore Army's member, the Hogwarts student version of the Order of the Phoenix. When they knew it would come down to a fight, the DA member sent out word. Arthur and Molly got there as quickly as they could. Molly would try and argue with Ginny that she was too young and needed to leave with all the younger students. Ginny couldn't stand having her whole family at Hogwarts fighting and not knowing what was happening, so of course she found a way to stay. Percy would even show up to the battle. This caused everyone to freeze for a moment before Percy broke into apology, to which Molly broke into tears. She and Arthur would run straight for him and gave him the biggest, most loving hug they probably ever gave him. Molly and Arthur would help set up protections on the school before Voldemort shows up. These protections would eventually fail, and the Death Eaters would get in. There were spells, jinxes, and curses flying all over the place. There would, however, be a brief pause in the fight. Voldemort would give 1 hour for Harry to turn himself over to him. In this time, they could tend to their wounded and move bodies into the Great Hall. Sadly, not all the Weasleys made it through the start of the battle. Fred was one of the bodies that was carried into the Great Hall. Molly would lay herself over his chest and cry, as Arthur stroked her hair and cried too. The whole family was in an embrace of sadness. They didn't have as much time to grieve as they should have, because it wouldn't be long before Voldemort would return. When Voldemort and his Death Eaters walked back up to Hogwarts, they had Hagrid, who was tied up, carrying Harry's limp body. But Harry was still alive, and the battle would begin again. Arthur and Percy began to fight pie's thickness. Bellatrix wasn't too far away, fighting with Ginny, Hermione, and Luna. She let out a killing curse that just barely missed Ginny. Molly would throw off her cloak and run towards Bellatrix. The two would duel, and with one of Molly's spells hitting Bellatrix right in the chest, Bellatrix would be no more. Voldemort was angered by Molly taking down one of his most devoted followers. He would raise his wand to send a spell her way when Harry did a shield charm to protect her. Voldemort and Harry would have their final duel, which ended with Voldemort falling to the ground, dead. In this moment, there were cheers from the crowd that were fighting nearby. Death Eaters were trying to escape, but several were captured. It was now that everyone had time to let it all in. How hard they had fought, and grieve for those who didn't live long enough to see them win the war. They would all gather back in the Great Hall together. Molly and Ginny were sitting together, Ginny with her head gently placed on her mother's shoulder. Arthur and Molly would be able to bring their family back home to the Burrow safely. Arthur would return to work at the Ministry with Kingsley Shacklebolt as their new Minister for Magic. Over their years, their family grew, welcoming several grandchildren into the mix. Bill and Fleur had three children, Victoire, Dominique, and Louis. Percy would marry a woman named Audrey, and they would have two children, Molly and Lucy. George had stayed close to Angelina Johnson, and the two got married. They would have a son and a daughter, Fred and Roxanne. Ron and Hermione were finally together, and after they married, they had two children, Rose and Hugo. Ginny married Harry, and they had three children, James Sirius, Albus Severus, and Lily Luna. Arthur was a fun-loving and caring man, and Molly was a kind-hearted, motherly figure. The two of them were a perfect match. They raised seven children to be good and true people. They took Harry under their wing to make sure he had a family that loved him. Their doors were also always open to Hermione, even though she had a good home of her own. They loved with every bone in their body, and without them, the wizarding world would have been a very different place. This has been the story of Arthur and Molly Weasley. Thank you for listening. If you enjoyed this video and want to support the channel, please consider giving a like and drop a comment. You can also subscribe for more videos. I'll be back again soon with another video, but until then, keep enjoying the magic.